Good morning, students. So yesterday we started off the rat trap, and today we are going to continue with this. The first part we had almost done, where we got to know like the rat trap seller, how he used to manage his livelihood. So how did he manage his livelihood? He would make the rat traps and he would sell them. He would go for door to door, you know, selling of the rat traps. Then he would that would not be enough to keep his body and soul together. Then he would even go for begging and stealing also. So he would beg, steal, and sell rat traps to survive. But even then, he was not able to live a happy or contented life, because his clothes were still in rags, cheeks were sunken, and hunger gleamed in his eyes. So his life was actually very boring, because he would keep on plodding along the road and he would just be left to his own meditations throughout the day. So he had no company for whole of the day. And in this way, during all these ploddings, when he would be just talking to himself, when he would be just meditating upon his own thoughts, then one day he came upon one philosophy that the whole world is a big rat trap. And we all human beings are stuck in this trap. So how the world is a big rat trap? Because the world offers so many beautiful things. The world offers so many temptations because of the beautiful things it has in store for us. And we the human beings, so far we remain away from those temptations. So far we remain steadfast on our way to on our way to reach our destination. We remain away from this rat trap. But the moment we become greedy, the moment we get tempted to those temptations, that very minute we get trapped into the rat trap, and we find it difficult to come out of this. So this rat trap seller, you know, he had this idea that this whole world is a big rat trap, and all human beings are trapped inside. So the whole world with its lands and seas, its cities and villages, was nothing but a big rat trap. It had never existed for any other purpose than to set baits for people. So what are baits? Bait actually is any food or any eatable which you keep in the trap to attract the animal. Okay? So bait is some temptation. Bait is something which is offered as a temptation to trap the others. So it offered riches, joys, shelter and food, heat and clothing, exactly as the rat trap offered cheese and pork. And as soon as anyone let himself be tempted to touch the bait, it closed in on him, and then everything came to an end. Aman, keep yourself updated with the news. Okay, today the news might come up and exams will be there, yes. Okay, so be ready for the exams, but the format and all will be declared. Like how, what kind of examination would be there. And moreover, keep yourself updated with the news nowadays. The world had of course never been very kind to him, so it gave him unwanted joy to think ill of it in this way. So why did he think about the world like being a rat trap? Because the world had never been kind towards him. How can you say that the world was never kind towards him? How can you say this, that the world was never kind to him? Because he never got the reward of his hard work. He worked so hard, but even then he lived a miserable life. Right? So it became a cherished pastime of his during many dreary ploddings to think of people he knew who had let themselves be caught in the dangerous snare, and of others who were still circling around the bait. So it became his cherished pastime. So it became his favorite pastime, that whenever he would be walking along the roads, he would think about the people whom he knew, the ones who had let themselves be caught in the dangerous snare. So he would think about the people who had already become the victims of the trap and the others who were going to be entrapped very soon. One dark evening, as he was trudging along the road, he caught sight of a little grey cottage by the roadside, and he knocked on the door to ask shelter for the night. So one evening when he was walking or plodding along the road, he saw that there was one dark grey cottage along the roadside, and he knocked at the door to seek shelter. So this was a routine with him, like whenever he would get late on the way, he would seek shelter here and there. So on that particular evening, he knocked at the door at that cottage because it was getting darker, and he would take shelter there. Nor was he refused. Instead of the sour faces which ordinarily met him, the owner, who was an old man without wife or child, was happy to get someone to talk to in his loneliness. So very important here. When he knocked at the door of that cottage because he wanted to take shelter for the night, and he was given shelter, and not like the other times, like usually whenever he would knock at the door of somebody, then people would make bad faces, people would make bitter faces or sour faces, they would never welcome him. So he would get shelter earlier also, but never ever the way he got this time. So this time the host was a very generous person. He welcomed him. And that host, you know, why did he welcome him? Maybe he was all alone. He did not have his wife. He did not have his children. So he was happy to have somebody with him so that he could talk to in his loneliness. Got it? So one reason that this host was a kind person, one reason maybe because he did not have anyone to talk to. And when he found this man coming to his house to take shelter, he found somebody to be the one with whom he would be able to talk to. Immediately he put the porridge pot on fire and gave him supper. So that person offered him porridge. He put the porridge pot on fire and gave him supper. Then he carved off such a big slice from his tobacco roll that it was enough for both the stranger's pipe and his own. So first he made him have dinner or supper with porridge. Then he gave him a tobacco roll. Okay, he started enjoying his tobacco roll for himself, and he even gave one to this man. Finally, he got out an old pack of cards and played chowries with his guest until bedtime. So after the tobacco roll, that person offered this man, he started playing with him a game of cards, right? So how did this man welcome the rat trap seller? Answer is that he offered him porridge, he offered him tobacco roll, and even played a game of cards with him. Got it? So the old man was just as generous with his confidences as with his porridge and tobacco. So we have just now read that that host was very generous. He gave him tobacco roll, he gave him porridge. Not only this, that man, that host, even shared his secrets with this man. That was too much. If somebody comes to our house, okay, we are like very hospitable sometimes, but at least telling our secrets, that is very different thing. So he was generous with his confidences. So meaning is that he told him his secrets also. The guest was informed at once that in his days of prosperity, his host had been a crofter at Ramchur's ironworks. So who that host was? That host was actually like when he was young, in the days of his prosperity, like when he was young, then he was rich also, and then he had been a crofter at Ramchur's ironworks. So then he worked in the Ramchur's ironworks as a crofter and had worked on the land. Now that he was no longer able to do day labor, it was his cow which supported him. So when he was young, he worked as a crofter at Ramchur's ironworks, right? But now because he had become old, so he could not do day labor. So now it was his cow which was supporting him live well. So it was his cow which supported him. Yes, that Bossy was extraordinary. She could give milk for the creamery every day, and last month he had received all of the 30 kroners in payment. So this man, you know, told him that last month he received 30 kroners as a payment, thereby selling the cream which he had got from the cow. So this host, he was so hospitable, he was so generous, that he not only offered him porridge and tobacco, not only gave him his valuable time by playing cards with him, he even told him the secret, like how much money he had and how he got it. He told him that he had got about 30 kroners, and that money he had got by selling cream which he bought from cow. Got it? The stranger must have seemed incredulous, for the old man got up and went to the window, took down a leather pouch which hung on a nail in the very window frame, and picked out 3 wrinkled 10 kroner bills. So the stranger might not have believed his own eyes with what he saw. Because then the old man, that host, got up, he went to the window. From there, he took down a leather pouch which was hanging on a nail in the very window frame. And then he picked out 3 wrinkled 10 kroner bills. So in the previous paragraph, this host had told the rat trap seller that he had got 30 kroners. And that was enough. But that was not enough. The host even went to the window frame. From there, he brought 1 leather pouch and he took out the 3 10 kroner bills. That is, he showed him the money. He showed him that currency which he had with him. He first told him that he had 30 kroners, then he even showed him that money. Isn't it unbelievable? Does anyone do this kind of thing? Number one, no one tells others like how much money one has. Number one. But secondly, one definitely never shows the money to the other person like this. And that also a stranger. These he held up before the eyes of his guest. These he held up. Who is he? The host. The one who had been a crofter at the Ramchur's ironworks when he was young. So this host, this crofter. So remember, this host is a crofter in the story. Right? So this host showed that money to the rat trap seller. Nodding knowingly, and then stuffed them back into the pouch. So afterwards, when he had showed the money to him, he put it back in the pouch and kept it there as it is. So where did he keep the money, or where did he keep the pouch? He kept the pouch near the window sill or on the wooden window frame. The next day, both men got up in good season. The crofter was in a hurry to milk his cow, and the other man probably thought that he should not stay in bed when the head of the house had gotten up. So next morning, both of them got up. The crofter, you know, he had to milk his cow, so he got up a bit earlier. And the rat trap seller thought that if the host has got up, then he must also get up as a matter of fact. So they left the cottage at the same time. Very important. The crofter locked the door and put the key in his pocket. The man with the rat trap said goodbye and thank you, and thereupon each went his own way. So in the morning, both of them got up. Both of them went to their own respective paths. The old man, the crofter, he went to one side, and the other man, you know, the rat trap seller, he went towards his own way. But before they went off, the rat trap, the crofter, he had locked the door and he kept the keys in his pocket, right? But half an hour later, the rat trap peddler stood again before the door. So after half an hour, the rat trap seller, the peddler, the tramp, the vagabond, these are all adjectives for this rat trap seller. So after half an hour, this peddler came back again near the door of that cottage. So why did he come back? So why do you think he has come back now? Yes? Why do you think he has come back now? Can you make any guess? The crofter had shown him the money. He had shown him that leather pouch which contained 30 kroners, and he even showed him the place where that money was kept. So what was that? So that was, yes, Vanshika, Manvia, they are all saying that he had come there to steal the money, right? So but half an hour later, the rat trap peddler stood again there at the door. He did not try to get in. However, he only went up to the window, smashed a pane, stuck in his hand, and got hold of the pouch with the 30 kroners. He took the money and thrust it into his own pocket. Then he hung the leather pouch very carefully back in its place and went away. So what does rat trap seller do? He came to that cottage. He went up to the window. He broke the window pane and he put his hand inside. He took the leather pouch, took out the money, and kept the empty pouch there back at its place. And he went away. So he stole the money. So in the previous evening, the crofter had shown him the leather pouch containing money. So what he had done, the crofter had actually shown him a bait. He had given him a bait. And this rat trap seller, stole that money, he had actually been entrapped now. So the world offers us baits in one form or the other. And the moment we become greedy, the moment we become tempted to touch the bait, that very minute we get entrapped in the rat trap. Then we become a rat, because the basic nature of a rat is being greedy. So about half an hour later, the rat trap peddler stood again before the door. So this we have done. As he walked along with the money in his pocket, he felt quite pleased with his smartness. So in the beginning, the rat trap seller was very happy. He was like proud of his being so smart. He realized, of course, that at first he dared not continue on the public highway, but must turn off the road into the woods. So children, this is what usually happens. When we try to cheat somebody, when we deceive somebody, when we rob off somebody of one's money or something, then we think that we are very smart. But we don't realize that we have actually become the rat. We have actually been trapped in the rat trap. Actually, it's the theory of karma. What's the theory of karma? That what you do, same you get back. Okay, if you do bad, then bad will come back to you. If you do good, then good will come back to you. So if you have robbed somebody of something, then you will also be robbed of something. So here the rat trap seller has robbed the crofter of money. And you will see that this rat trap seller will be robbed of his peace of mind. Right now you will see that he will lose that peace of mind which he had earlier. Earlier he might not have enough money. He was poor, no problem, no doubt. But at least he was at peace with himself. At least he was, free. At least he did not have any fear of anyone. At least he did not have any sense of guilt. But now, after he stole the money of that innocent crofter, the crofter who had been so nice with him, afterwards this man will lose all that peace of mind. He will lose all that sense of security. He lose all that sense of protection, and he will be constantly in that cloud of fear. He will be always afraid that somebody or the other might catch him, right? So immediately the result has started coming up. He realized that at first he dared not continue on the public highway. So he realized that he should not continue on the public highway. Why should not he continue on the public highway? Because the police might be after him. Okay, maybe the crofter might have informed the police and the police might be in search of him. So he decided not to go via public highway. But he must turn off the road into the woods. So he decided to take an off route through the forest. During the first hours, this caused him more difficulty. So when you do something wrong, when you cheat somebody, in the beginning, the things seem to be all right. Everything seems to be all right. But later in the day, it became worse. For it was a big and confusing forest which he had gotten into. So in the beginning, when he was going via forest, then the things were all right. But as it started getting darker, he realized that he had been lost in that big and confusing forest. He tried to be sure to walk in a definite direction, but the paths twisted back and forth so strangely. He walked and walked without coming to the end of the wood. And finally, he realized that he had only been walking around in the same part of the forest. So what happened? So in the beginning, everything was fine. But in the evening, he realized that he had been lost. He thought that he was very smart. So he tried to keep himself moving in one direction. Despite that, in the end, he realized that he had been moving in just one part of the forest only, because he found himself coming back to the same point after having walked so long. Got it? So he was not able to get out of that tricky forest. All at once he recalled his thoughts about the world and the rat trap. So now he was reminded of his own theory that the world is a big rat trap. Now his own turn had come. Now he himself has been trapped. But why now his turn has come? Because he had become greedy earlier. He had let himself be fooled by a bait and had been caught. So no one's fault. He only allowed himself be fooled by the bait. And he had been caught in the rat trap. So the whole forest with its trunks and branches, its thickets and fallen logs, closed in upon him like an impenetrable prison from which he could never escape. So the whole forest with its trunks, branches, its thick bushes, fallen wooden planks, closed in upon him like an impenetrable prison. What is impenetrable? Something through which you cannot pierce. So he had been enclosed in that big forest and there was no way out for him, right? So he had been caught in the forest. So in a way, he had been caught in the trap. Okay. So what made him get trapped? His own greed. It was late in December. Darkness was already descending over the forest. This increased the danger and increased also his gloom and despair. So it was the month of December. And in December, you know, number one, the darkness comes up a bit earlier. And secondly, it happens to be very, very cold. So that increased the danger. In case he would not be able to go out of the forest before the night falls, what will happen to him in the forest in that kind of weather? You can imagine. What can happen to him? He might die of cold in the forest, or he might die because of some animal in the forest. So there was no hope if he would not be able to get out of this forest. So that increased the danger and increased his gloom and despair. So why his gloom and despair increased? Because staying in the forest at night was no less than being in the lap of death. Finally, he saw no way out and he sank down on the ground, tired to death, thinking that his last moment had come. So finally, when he was not able to go out of this forest, when he was not able to find a way out, he gave up and he realized that his end had come. Why did he realize like this? Because he was dead tired. But just as he laid his head on the ground, he heard a sound. A hard, regular thumping. There was no doubt as to what that was. He raised himself. So what happened when he lied on the ground, when he lay on the ground? He heard some thumping sound coming from one side. So he got up. Those are the hammer strokes from an iron mill, he thought. So actually those sounds were coming from an iron mill. So there must be people nearby. He summoned all his strength, got up and staggered in the direction of the sound. So though he was dead tired, yet he gathered all his strength, he got up and started walking in the direction from where the sound was coming. Okay, so from which place was the sound coming? It was coming from some mill, from some iron mill. And can you imagine like which mill might be there now? What kind of mill or what kind of, you know, factory he might come up to now? Let me again remind you that the theory of karma is really very, very, you know, authentic theory. So what we do, what we sow, it comes back to us. So he had deceived the crofter. And the crofter had already been working at Ram's Chose Iron Works when he was young, right? So he had deceived the crofter and now he will be seeking shelter in the same Ram's Chose Iron Works. Though the crofter is not working there now, yet you can imagine that the crofter might have got his associations with the owner of the mill. Right. So now the Ram's Chose Iron Works, which are now closed down, were not so long ago a large plant with smelter, rolling mill and forge. In the summertime, long lines of heavily loaded barges and scows slid down the canal, which led to a large inland lake. And in the winter time, the roads near the mill were black from all the coal dust which sifted down from the big charcoal craters. So here is a description of the Ram's Chose Iron Works, which are closed down. But not very long ago, that was a very large plant. So when was it a very large plant? When even the crofter might have also been there. So then this Ram's Chose Iron Works had all those big machines and devices with which you can say, like, it really had a good name. During one of the long dark evenings, just before Christmas, the master smith and his helper sat in the dark forge near the furnace, waiting for the pig iron, which had been put in the fire, to be ready to put out on the anvil. Every now and then, one of them got up to stir the glowing mass with a long iron bar, returning in a few moments, dripping with perspiration, though, as was the custom, he wore nothing but a long shirt and a pair of wooden shoes. So in that Ramsar's iron works, now in the evening, who was there? Right now there, one was the master smith and another one was his helper. They were there in the dark forge and they were doing the work. Right? So why were they there in the work, in the mill? Because on the eve of Christmas, they might have to send some consignment. So they might be very busy during these days to do the needy things, to do the things which were to be done very urgently. So even the night round, night shift was also going on. During one of the long dark evenings, just before Christmas, this we have done, all the time there were many sounds to be heard in the forge. The big bellows groaned and the burning coal cracked. The fire boy shoveled charcoal into the maw of the furnace with a great deal of clatter. Outside roared the waterfall and a sharp north wind whipped the rain against the brick-tiled roof. So from inside the mill, many sounds were coming. So maybe the boy who was like shoveling the charcoal into the furnace. So many sounds were coming from the mill. And outside there was the uproar of waterfall, or maybe the roar or the sound created by the sharp north winds. And that was whipping against the rain. It was probably on account of all this noise that the blacksmith did not notice that a man had opened the gate and entered the forge until he stood close up to the furnace. So there was so much of noise that the blacksmith, he did not notice that a person had opened a door, opened the gate and had come inside near the furnace. Got it? So who this man, who was this man who had come inside? Who was this man? Come on. Who had come inside the forge now? Who had come inside the forge or the mill? Who had come inside the forge or the mill? Come on. Charanjyoti, you tell. Yes, Charanjyot.
Hello, ma'am.
Who had come inside the mill? The rat trap seller. Okay, the rat trap seller had come inside the mill, and the blacksmith who was already working in the mill, he did not notice the entry of anyone in the mill because of so much of noise in the mill. Got it? And that rat trap seller had taken shelter in the mill now at night. Got it? Okay, we have done up till page number 35. Tomorrow we'll pick up from this very page. And tomorrow before we start, there will be some short questions I'll be asking you. So prepare, read the story side by side as much we people have done here. All right?